It's been called the Blue Belt, suburbia, and depending on where you live, various other things as well. Much is made over the so-called social divide between the 905 and the 416, Toronto's major area code. 2 decades since its creation, who and what is today's 905, and what's its role in the region? Joining us to talk about that, Janet Ecker, former Ontario Cabinet Minister, now the President of the Toronto Financial Services Alliance. Brian Crombie, Chair of the Western GTA Summit. Radcliffe Dockery, Board Member at the Canada Southern Africa Chamber of Business. And Matt Gurney, columnist at the National Post. Hello to you all, you 905ers. Thank you for coming into the 416. We are going to talk about the 905, and we know it's a vast area. We'll get to that in a minute, but let's go around the table. Where in the 905 do you?
Durham region.
Peel region, Brampton.
I live in the York region now.
The greatest city in the GTA, Mississauga.
Okay. I moved here in 95 from Saskatchewan. And when I came here, people used to rattle off things about the 905, like it was some sort of universal code, like 911. I had no idea what they're talking about then. I do now, but it is interesting, even when you ask people here in the 416 or the 905 to explain what comprises the 905, they have a hard time. So we are going to show you a map. Here is a map of the region. Divide between the 905 and the 416 area codes. There is the 416 traditional area code for the City of Toronto. The 905, traditional area code for the suburbs around Toronto, including municipalities such as Mississauga, Richmond Hill, and Ajax. Matt Gurney, is it just an area code, a geographic region, or what more is there to the 905?
I think it largely is an area code and a geographic region. I mean, just that map you were just showing, I mean, it's a gigantic physical space. Toronto itself is a large city, just geographically by city standards, and you could fit probably 15 of them into the space of the 905. But, you know, there are parts of the 905 that actually I would say have a political, economic, or even cultural identity. But when you actually look at some of them and you put them side by side, they're very different. Looking at where I'm from in New York region, you could easily say that cities like Markham and Vaughan and the town of Richmond Hill, if you lump them all together, you're looking at a city that's fairly cohesive and would have 750,000 people. Compare that to, say, Brampton or Mississauga or Hamilton, there's not a lot of difference. So 905 is mostly useful as an abstraction, as a way of saying the suburbs, but as a cohesive entity, I don't think there's much to it.
Radcliffe, is there an identity that we can put on the 905, a cohesive identity?
There used to be one. So when we moved in 87, it was all about you got the bigger house, the bigger yard, and you could slow down a little bit in life. But now the 905 has become a major city. I grew up in Mississauga. Mississauga is the seventh largest city in Canada. Mississauga, Brampton combined are 1.2 million people. And so all of a sudden now, the 905, what the image is not relevant anymore because we live in a big city with lots of traffic, with lots of issues, with lots of good things as well. But the 905, at least for us in the West End, in the Peel region, no, 905 is just a number. It's a way to contact me. That's all it is.
All right, Janet, what is the link between all you 905ers? Are there things that you all share in common that you talk about?
Well, I think there certainly used to be. I think the points that have been made about as it becomes increasingly urban, I think the differences that used to be there, say when I ran for election in 1995, there was a clear distinction between people. I mean, you could almost tell the difference. And I like to joke that as the Toronto Star has expanded its circulation out through the GTA, it's helped to homogenize that approach, if you will. But I think folks who were in 905, it used to be, you know, you went there to raise a family. You went there to have a house with a plot of land around it that actually felt like a house and not a postage stamp. So things like, you know, schools and soccer fields and, you know, Tim Hortons coffee. I mean, you know, generalizing here, and it's a bit of a stereotype, but it was actually very true and very much more, again, commonsensical, if you will, in terms of how they approach life and the issues that they thought were important and what they saw the role of government of being. So, but I think it's much more homogenized now. And again, the other thing that's helped, I think, influence that has just been the growing diversity of the population throughout 905 as well.
Brian, you know, there has been also historically in the last 2 decades a growing sense of tension between the 416 and the 905. How do you see that playing out these days?
I think the tension is growing, and I actually think I disagree with everyone else on this panel in regards to this. If you take out Niagara Region and Hamilton, which I think do not feel part of the 905 or the ring around the donut is the way that some people describe it, I think the balance of the area around Toronto actually does feel fairly cohesive and fairly different than the 416. And so therefore, in answer to your first question about the difference between the 905, it's that it's not the 416. It's not Toronto. But I think that the people in Durham and in York and in Peel and in Halton have a lot of similarities. And they are some of the things that Janet talked about in regards to, you know, having a home and raising a family and not living in as urban an environment as they do in Toronto. And having common frustrations, frustrations in regards to transit, frustrations in regards to feeling less connected to Toronto, having problems getting down to Toronto and to your studio. And I think, you know, incredible amount of diversity, which is a challenge. It could be an opportunity as well, but it is a challenge. And, you know, you think about Mississauga and Brampton, something like 57% of the people in Mississauga and Brampton have been in Canada for less than 10 years. You know, it's an amazing statistic. And so that, you know, you used to think that all the people that were immigrating to Canada came to Toronto. Well, it's not true anymore. A lot of those people actually are coming to the 905 around Toronto. So I think that the divide is there. I think that the current mayor of Toronto has only accentuated that divide. I think that the Metrolink's big move controversy and the controversy in regards to the Scarborough subway has accentuated that big move, accentuated that difference. And I think it is a real separation within the greater Toronto area.
You talk about, you know, part of being part of the 905 is that you're not the 416 as a defining character, much in the same way, Matt, that, you know, as Canadians, we sometimes define ourselves by not being American.
Well, that's basically all we've ever had. We're developing more now, but traditionally it was we're not quite British, we're not quite American, we're maybe something in the middle. I mean, Brian, to your point, I think it's interesting. If we were to actually look at, if we were to set the bar, what would we define the 905 as and get a real collective identity for all of it? No, I'll agree with you. Let's discount Niagara as just being maybe too geographically removed, and Hamilton's a city with its own identity. If we take something that would be kind of a pan 905 vision, I don't think it stops at Steeles Avenue. I mean, you would then have to fold in large parts of the 416 into that vision of, as you said, I mean, the bigger houses. I think, Janet, you'd made the point. I mean, bigger houses, the Tim Hortons, I mean, all of this stuff. There's large parts of the 416 that have that same identity. So if we're going to actually start, if we're going to treat the 416 as a concrete individual entity, then I think how we would define the 905 maybe changes.
One of the things that you might want to use to tell the difference between a 416er and a 905er is what you think of cars. Because in the 905, while there are transportation issues, you know, challenges, I mean, there it's roads and GO trains, where, you know, in Toronto, people talk about transportation policy as being walking paths and bike lanes. So there's a big difference there, I think. And one of the frustrations, like that where some of the tensions come from, I think, is when people in our, let's say, in Durham region hear Torontonians, if I can put it that way, talking about, oh, well, let's tear down the Gardiner. Who needs it anyway? And there's a whole bunch of people who use that on a daily basis to come in from the east who think it's pretty important to their commute. So I think that transportation issue is a real defining issue for people who come from different regions.
You mentioned the idea of Metrolinx and trying to come up with a transit policy. You all drove in here today, right? You all came
in.
GO Train. And we are pre-taping because we didn't want to get you guys into trouble with traffic, getting back out to your various points in the 905. Brian, talk to me a little bit about that power imbalance between the 905 and the 416. Where does it play out?
Well, I think Metrolinx is one of the best examples. And a couple of years ago, people were saying, you know, Metrolinx is a great example of how the whole region can work together. And I think, frankly, in the last couple of years, Metrolinx has been the opposite example. And it's been the, you know, the example of how we're not working together. Because the reality is Metrolinx was established to think about transit from an overall Toronto region standpoint. And politicians were taken off the board, were not allowed onto the board, so that it would be a sort of experts making the right decisions. And then what ended up happening? They came up with a big plan, and one mayor could change everything. Obviously a powerful mayor, a mayor of the major city in the area, but clearly one mayor completely threw out the whole big move and everything to do with the Metrolinx. So Metrolinx is actually an example of how we're not working together and how Toronto dominates the debate. And so what we had last May was something called the Western GTA Summit, and we had a tagline for that summit, the West Wants In. And we obviously played off of the Preston Manning, you know, the West wanted in into the Canadian debate, and we grew an unbelievable amount. We started out being three cities. It ended up being two regions and seven cities and towns that wanted to get involved. We had great attendance. We had great media. And it was because people in that part of the 905, and frankly, we had people in Markham and Durham saying, make it a ring around the donut conference. Don't make it just the Western GTA, because I think that the sense in Durham and in York was very similar, that the conversation on what was the right transit was being completely taken over by City Hall and Downtown Relief Line or Scarborough extension of a subway and things like that. And what was important to people that use the GO train or people that would want transit in Mississauga or Brampton or York was being completely no attention was being made by media, which is another problem we have. All of the media we have in this area, other than the Hamilton Spectator, is very Toronto focused. I had a big announcement at the Peel Region office, and one of the columnists, a GTA columnist from a major Toronto newspaper, wanted to come, and the person called me up and said, but you're going to have to pick me up at the subway stop because I don't have a car and I can't, get out. So, too many of the columnists that say they're GTA columnists are downtown Toronto focused. They don't know what goes on in Richmond Hill or in Durham or in Peel or Brampton. They don't even know those places exist.
Well, and I think a lot of it, too, was that this was an area that had high growth needs. I mean, that was sort of the every time you drove around, there was a new subdivision popping up somewhere. There used to be a Greater Toronto Area Hospital Coalition because the hospitals in the 905 area were very frustrated because all the funding formulas were not responding to their growth needs. So that had provoked a whole provincial policy issue. But the other thing that's happening is you've got the Durham region, the east, that is feeling it looks at the west and it says, well, you guys don't have problems. You got all this money. You got all, whatever, and us poor folks out in Durham region are underfunded because, again, Durham's growth started to happen just in time for government cutbacks. So that was another tension. And when I, my caucus colleagues and I, there were five of us all from the same party in Durham region, and we actually, had a little strategic plan about how between the five of us we were going to gang up on the rest of 905 and whatever to try and get some of the linkages out there and the funding that we needed. And when we were fighting to get 401 expanded out into Durham region and 407. And I can remember one of the officials at Transportation saying, nah, the traffic volume doesn't justify it. So when I got to be a minister, you've got a little bit more clout. I used to schedule meetings in my constituency office at 4 o'clock on a Friday afternoon and say to them, so how do you like the traffic volume studies now? So we did. I mean, it did start to go out. But so there's all kinds of growth related pressures that I think help drive a lot of that difference with 416 and 905.
I would say with the 416, the 905, 416, that's why I say the divide's not as big anymore. Because if you're in certain parts of Etobicoke, certain parts of Scarborough, it feels like you're in the suburbs. Certain parts of Scarborough feels like you're in Scarborough. Certain parts of Scarborough feels like you're in Ajax, et cetera. I'll say to that, the 905 debate now within the 905 might be greater. So for instance, when I see the York sub, I went to York. So now when I see the York GO train from, GO bus from Mississauga go straight to York University, I cry. I say, where was that when I was struggling in my car on the 401?
Out of jealousy?
Yes, out of jealousy. I mean, I know where all my tuition went at least, right? But then the next part of it, but then I see, the new TCC subway stop being built in Vaughan, and I say, what the heck's going on? Mississauga, who led the 905 development in the first place, who had the big growth, we sat there, we voted in governments consecutively, and no government did anything to help us get a subway station. We need one in Mississauga. We are a large, Mississauga's a large city. So that kind of divide makes us start to wonder in Mississauga and Brampton and say, what the heck's going on? You look at the road construction. Who decided to build the 410 straight up to Brampton and not think you need some kind of parallel road to the 410? If the province knows, telling you, you have to develop based on density targets, who was the brainiac who said you don't need relief roads along the way off the 410? Because the 410 is worse than the Don Valley Parkway. So I think in those type of things, I think there's a lot of debate and there's a lot of concern for some of my friends when we talk around the table saying, when Hazel steps down, who's going to be the strong voice in the West to say, Toronto, okay, we'll argue with you over TTC and, I'm not paying any extra taxes because property taxes for us are way higher than Toronto. I'm no crocodile tears here. But at the same time, I want to know why a place like Vaughan, that's still not a fraction of the size that we are, is getting what they're getting. Is it because of...
They elected a finance minister.
And I think people have those type of discussions. I think that leads to the next point is, in the 905, it's an issue of transparency. Because the media does not cover, we need more transparency in municipal government in the 905. Linda Jackson is an example. I don't know. I'm in Brampton right now, and we scratch our head saying, what are we doing around City Hall? What's going on with the hydro surplus money? No, what's going on in all these cities? What's Mississauga going to do when the development revenue stops? So we have to start asking ourselves in the 905 first, what are we doing? Because we're not the little sister anymore. We are a big brother at the table.
I think Brian might know who he wants to be the next mayor of Mississauga. But anyway,
I
have a point of the issue, and I think it will be a strong, powerful person. But the reality is institutions matter. And no matter how strong of a person you have in Mississauga, when you have 2.4 million people in not the whole 905, but in the four regions right around Toronto, versus 2.6 million people in Toronto. You have one mayor for that 2.6 million people and one council for that 2.6 million people, and 24 mayors and 24 councils for the 2.4 million people that are in the 905 around, excluding Hamilton and Niagara. You end up not being able to have the voice. You know, back to this Western GTA Summit, I had meetings with Mayor Fennell in Brampton and Mayor Burton in Oakville, and they said, you know what, if we make a comment on transit and the importance of transit, we might be lucky to get a paragraph in the major downtown Toronto newspapers. But if the mayor of Toronto, you know, whatever he does, it'll end up being a big issue. And we've seen just in the last by-election in Scarborough how a political football of a subway extension can be taken over because of the importance of and the cohesive nature of Toronto. And you go back 25 years, you know, Anne Golden, who did the Greater Toronto Area Report, what she actually never said was an amalgamation of all of Toronto. What she wanted was an expansion of Metro Toronto and have the 905 have seats on some sort of a council. So I think what we need to do is we need to think through some institutional methodologies to have the whole voice of the Greater Toronto Area. And one of the lines that someone used at our Western GTA Summit, which I thought was great, is we need someone to put the great back in the Greater Toronto Area, because we're no longer the Greater Toronto Area. We're Toronto. And we're the suburbs around Toronto. And you take a look at London, you take a look at Denver, you take a look at LA, you know, cities worldwide that have made it work. They've made some sort of a metropolitan city government or even an ad hoc committee that gets together on a regular basis work so that people can do things on a planning cohesive basis.
Some of the problem right now, though, I mean, I agree with a lot of that, but the 416, especially on the transit issue, which is really what we keep coming back to, the 416 is so dysfunctional all by itself. That's a problem that needs to get fixed, or else no one from the 905 is going to be able to get into it. I mean, I can take a GO train that's going to get me right downtown in good time and for a relatively affordable price every morning. Then what do? I'm stuck at Union Station, and if I have to go more than basically a few blocks up Yonge Street or out across Bloor, I got nowhere to go. It's just not worth it. So if in order for the 905 to really have much value getting into the 416, you need to be able to move around within it. And I think I think an important thing for the 905 is to have an effective transit system within Toronto, because we got to go somewhere. I mean, we were joking before we started taping. Every 905er has their little secret cheat route to get into Toronto. Mine gets busier every day. I have to leave 5 minutes earlier every year that goes by, because even
the streets are filling up.
And, you know, just commuting up from the National Post to my home in York Region, I used to be able to leave at 4 o'clock and I'd beat all the traffic. Now it's about 3:40. And that's 5 years. So unless people can move around within the city and get Torontonians out of their cars, and it's got to be convenient for them, it's got to be affordable, there's not going to be any road space for the 905ers to get into the city. I mean, that's what happens. You drive down out of your nice little suburb, and you go by all the picket fences and the parks and the Tim Hortons, and then you hit the freeway, like you said, the 410, or you get into the city itself, and it's gridlock. And the thing that scares me is the gridlock's not on the freeways, it's everywhere. There's nowhere else for the cars to go.
Yeah, and I think that leads to a point we talk about. 905, 416 is all about traffic. Mm-hmm. We all complain about it in a 905, no matter where you are.
We complain about it in the 416, too.
Yeah, but I think part of the problem is where does everyone work? So I think the economic development engines of the 905 have to improve. I think Mississauga's been very strong in this in economic development and trying to attract businesses to Mississauga so more people living in Mississauga could actually work in Mississauga. Problem is Mississauga has to deal with some of its road issues, and so does Brampton. I said with the Brampton Director of Economic Development, they have a great plan, but it's heavily residential leaning. So where are the businesses going to go when they could come here? So we need to think about an economic development plan across the 905 as well. The 407, it helps. I know, I remember when I was a summer student at IBM in Markham, and I lived in Mississauga. Every day I took TTC. Then one day I heard the 407 was open. It was free for the first month. So it's like, wow, I could get to work so quickly. This is beautiful. Then they turned the price back up, and then the 407 is basically the Indy 500 now if you're not careful. So I think I would look at saying the 905 needs to work on, I mean, to the summit, you know, work on the economic development issues to bring in more business, to get more of us off the roads in Toronto.
You know, our viewers in Thunder Bay and Sudbury are pulling out their maps of Southern Ontario, looking up 407, 410, trying to figure out where exactly you're talking about. Brian, go ahead.
From the Google.
I think this is the key. And I worry that too much of the conversation that we've been having has been about congestion. And it's more than congestion. Clearly, congestion is the problem. But the solutions and what good transit could do for the city are very different. And you just take a look at a couple of other places worldwide. London, Greater London, got a congestion charge, got a fast rail to go from Heathrow to the City of London based on economic development. It was actually your area. They said they were losing financial services jobs to the continent because people took a half a day to get from Heathrow to the City of London. And they had a mayor who stood up and said, this is the London with crappy transit. And this is the global financial center that London will be with great transit, and got people to get excited about that. LA was all about connectivity, and they said, you know what, we can't get to Disney, we can't get to Santa Monica, we can't get to Beverly Hills, we can't get to the San Fernando Valley. We can have, clearly congestion was the problem in LA, but they talked about how critically important connectivity was. So you could go to Unionville to see the Markham Fair or the Unionville Festival. You could go to the wonderful festivals that are down in Port Credit. But in Toronto, you can't do that because you can't get around. Vancouver, they had a mayor talk about if we have transit, we have a livable, beautiful, mixed-use, so walkable downtown, rather than, you know, big expressways that dump people out. We have completely focused on congestion as the issue, and I think it's economic development, it's jobs, it's infrastructure, it's connectivity. It's the kind of vision for a Toronto that we all want to live in the next couple of years with great transit, rather than a Toronto that's going to end up being a Detroit if we don't put the investment in our infrastructure that we need.
Okay, we could spend all of our time talking about transit and congestion and gridlock, but I want to talk about some of the other issues that 905ers would like to have addressed. I want to go around the table. Janet, why don't you start?
Well, I think I touched on healthcare before because the hospitals that were in the 905 were getting, you know, really pressured because of the growth. And the funding formula, I mean, it's a lot of it has changed now, but there are still significant growth pressures out there that they're experiencing. And funding has tended to be, the sort of the hospital system has tended to be dominated by the sort of University Avenue hospitals, you know, that kind of thing. That is changing because some of those so-called community hospitals are now large, and they're starting to have clout in the system. But I think that is still a significant pressure is healthcare in terms of getting those services. It's a lot easier in a city to have services to people, you know, who are in their home. But when you have people who are more spread out, it's a little tougher to sort of do that. But I think Brian's point about if we're at a point to have some sort of metro-wide or GTA-wide mechanism for governance, I think one of the reasons why that would never worked before was because there were too many differences and was too much competition. So whether, as it becomes a more uniform region, whether there's an opportunity for that, there might well be. I am going to just also just take a bit of issue on the good old Metrolinx disclosure. I'm on the board. It was actually, and it is actually, a regional organization that is building regional transit. The challenge is that, yes, the political pressures interfered, as has happened every time, whether you agree or disagree with some of the political folks who were part of that, every time we've had a plan in this region, and it's happened many, many times, we get a political pressure point and it changes it and it all falls apart, and then we sort of are back to square one. So I'm not quite sure what the answer is, but I think the more that we can do to try and promote that regional vision, that people are to work together, find ways to do that. We're trying to do that in the economic development stuff we do in financial services to sort of do it, you know, more Toronto region, as we talk about Toronto region. But the more we can do that, I think the better to sort of get people to come at these issues and as a cohesive whole.
I know you want back in talking to Jan about Metrolinx, but I'm not.
Yeah, no, I know. Sorry. I couldn't resist.
Another time. Matt Gurney, what's an issue that 905ers want addressed in addition to transit and healthcare?
Well, I mean, it's related to both, actually. It's the issue of what kind of communities we're building right now. I mean, we've already set aside, and especially in New York region, I mean, also elsewhere, of course, I mean, large tracts of green space, and we're preserving this either to protect the water table, which is kind of important, or just because green space is pleasant and it's nice to have. But some of these GTA communities, and Mississauga is a big one, Richmond Hill, Vaughan as well, even though I have some agreement about the transit line there, they're building up. They're building up, and then before they're building out, because we're kind of running out of space. And I was driving up to my cottage a couple of months ago, and right up the 404, it's another one of those highways the viewers up north can look up, and they're extending the 404 to be about 50 kilometers out of downtown Toronto. And they're putting in high occupancy lanes because they're already foreseeing traffic jams going up that way. That's insane, and that scares me, the fact that you're going to be stuck in a traffic jam 50 kilometers from downtown. So then we get into the issue of, do we build up? Do we build condos? Do we build, you know, medium density, you know, 6 or 7 story condo buildings? A lot of people like the 905 because it was once upon a time the sleepy suburbs, and it was 4-bedroom detached houses. There's a lot of pushback against that now, and they have to figure out for themselves how they're going to do it. Some communities are better than others, but it's the fight that's happening now.
I want to bring up, just before we move on, I just want to pull up this map. Let's bring up the 905-416 map again that we had at the top of the show. Now, I want to put on top of the boundaries of the green belt. Matt's talking about green space over top of it. So those are, the provincial government is limiting future development on those areas in green. And Rad, as Matt says, you know, the suburbs are filling up. 905 municipalities, Mississauga, Vaughan, Markham, so on, are starting to create more densely populated neighborhoods. Is this then the end of the suburban lifestyle of the 905?
To me, it's been over for a while. It's been over for me about 7-8 years ago, the suburban lifestyle. That's what I talked about earlier. I mean, one issue has to be addressed at the Ontario Municipal Board. That has to be addressed. I know City of Toronto, Josh Cole, had some issues with it because I cannot believe some of the development. So before it was like, no, you got the 4-bedroom house with the nice backyard. Now you get the 4-bedroom house with no yard. You might as well live in a townhouse or you buy a detached house. Your neighbor, you could reach out through the window and hand them something. It's that ridiculous. Now, in Brampton, where I am, you can't drive anywhere north of Sandalwood. Everywhere is residential. I keep asking, where's everyone going to go? There was a big debate by Sandalwood area about a townhouse development that was going up, and it got pretty heated. And one local politician throughout the world, you're playing Indian politics to the local councillor. So you're starting to see within regions of the 905, you're seeing a lot of hot tensions now because the cultural elements, according to the old boys network, also to the incumbency. So it leads back to the issue of transparency at the 905 level and government. The number one issue for me in the 905 is to see government more transparent. I want to know, why do I see the same firm winning all the engineering contracts in Brampton for pre-development? It's the same firm. Where was the tender? Where was this tender? Where was the tender to build Brampton City Hall? Where was it? What's a competitive process? How do we ensure that local businesses in Peel Region have equal shots at business across the 905 and 416? Where is it? I see too much 905 politicians sitting on a soapbox saying we're doing a great job because it was a boom. Of course you're doing a great job. But when the development is going to run out in Brampton within 10 years, Mississauga, you're about maxed out. You're building up. And what kind of lifestyle are we living for people? There's a social deficit in the 905 because people have bought houses and the economic downturn 2008. They've had to sell a house and say, where am I going to live now? Can I have a place to live? Mississauga introduced recently last week Affordable Basement Act where they're going to enforce basement apartments now with a special fee. But that's one step. But how do we help those people who had to sell their house, who had to lose their house because they lost their job that paid them $90,000 and now they make $20,000? And I think the last part of the transparency piece is, no, we need some clarity. Because when I'm hearing Metrolinx saying you're going to increase my property taxes in the 905, I love you, Toronto. I grew up in Toronto up until I was 13 years old. Yes, get your subways. I'm all for you, man. Get the subways. But at the same time, no, where I live, I'm saying to myself, my property tax bill went up to a hospital in Brampton that's still closed in 2007. We have one hospital for a city of 500,000 people. When my wife was pregnant, we had a minor scare. I only had one hospital to go to. That matters. So what kind of lifestyle do we want people to live in the 905? That's a major question that I think local politicians, provincial and federal, want to go up there and do, you know, Oakville, we gave you $200 million for a plant. But the next element, I hear that you want to raise my taxes for Metrolinx.
Well, that's one of the other difference between 905 and 416. You go back to property tax because people in Toronto love to complain about their residential property tax. I know, same here. I mean,
you guys are giving me no reason to ever want to move out.
That's right. All of the 905 pays because the councils there knew that you had to pay for growth. That's you had right. to pay for infrastructure. Where in Toronto, what happened was they took the politically easy route for decades, and they would increase taxes on business, they would lower it or keep it lower on residential. And what they ended up doing is they drove literally in the early 90s, you know, something like 100,000 jobs were sort of leaving on a regular basis because business wouldn't be here, didn't want to be here because of the taxes. And so one of the reforms that when I was elected, one of the things that we did, and we certainly created a lot of controversy doing it, but was to change how they do the property taxes in Toronto to try and get that balance again.
But you could
again.
Argue, Janet, that more density in Toronto should result in lower property taxes.
Well, no. What I'm saying is that you have to pay for your infrastructure, and you've got taxpayers, I think, are prepared to pay for infrastructure, but they want to know that they're getting value for money, and that's always been the missing link. But in Toronto, for many, many years, it was like, you know, we want to have this great city, but we don't want to have to really pay the cost of what it's going to take to keep it a great city.
And that's part of the problem we have when we don't have some sort of wider organization, because based on value, and Torontonians don't understand this, but based on the value of homes, Torontonians actually pay some of the lowest property taxes in the whole greater Toronto area, and the 905 pays a higher amount. And I think that is one of the problems. But if I could, the two problems that I think exist for the 905, other than transit, which is critical, I think, is this idea of growth. And the growth is not going to impact everyone. It's not a problem for everyone. It's something like 85% of Mississauga and Brampton are going to stay the same. But 15 to 20% are going to change, and that's going to be here in Ontario. It's going to be around major transit nodes, and it's going to be around the major highways. And people have got to accept increased density in some areas. And then I think the other thing is how we're going to thrive. And growth has ended up being a big problem. We have something in Peel called Fair Share Peel, and it's been funded similarly in both York and Durham as well. We get 50% of the per capita funding for human and social services in Durham, York and Peel, as the balance of Ontario does. And the reason why is that governments just can't catch up with per capita growth. And you know, think in the next 10 to 15 years, people think that the city of Montreal is moving to the Greater Toronto Area. That's how big the growth is going to be in the Greater Toronto Area. And you know what? Some of it's going to move to Toronto, but most of it is coming to the area around Toronto, the 905.
Mm-hmm. And I'll give you four times in the 905.
I'll give you one easy example. Caledon. The North End, some people think is rural today, 50,000 people. Yeah. In the next 20 years, is going to grow tenfold to 500,000 people. It's going to be the size of Brampton in 15 to 20 years. So you think about Caledon and what the challenge they're going to have with hospitals, with healthcare, with human and social services, with schools, with infrastructure. They don't have a highway, let alone a GO train that comes to Caledon now, and it's going to go from 50,000 people to 500,000 people. And remember, we got 2.5 million people living in four regions around Toronto, 2.6 in Toronto. And you take a look at the show that you do on CFRB or any of the other shows that go on radio or TV or the national newspapers, we don't get half of the news. 90% of the news is what's happening in Toronto or what Mayor Toronto does and what a councillor in Toronto wants in Scarborough or Downtown Relief Fund. We don't get the attention. We don't get the media exposure. We don't have the institutional framework. We're forgotten.
And it comes back to the whole idea of, the Ontario Municipal Board. I keep coming back to this because the more I learned about it over the past couple of years, who's approving all this density planning? And what are they thinking? And who are they accountable to? The Ontario Municipal Board, can they answer to me? Can I call somebody? There's a formal appeal process you go through online, but let's be real, right? Who are they accountable to? Instead, I call my MP, my MPP, and my city council, and I rail at them. But who ultimately could override all the decisions?
But one of the challenges, though, Rad, is that we all sort of live in this wonderful dream world where we're going to have all this growth, we're going to have all this new population, and we still want to have, you know, the 120-foot square lot with a great big house on it, and yet we still want to put all.
Right?
I know, I understand there's process issues, but I think all of us collectively, I mean, if you cannot have the kind of growth that we're seeing and not expect to have to make compromises. I mean, you look at all of the, Toronto has been a city that's had the most cranes in the air of any city in the world. Most of them are condominium apartments, and you drive in some of the areas and you look at all these buildings, and like, you can't now walk down Bay Street at 4 o'clock and there's no room on the sidewalk, let alone room on the roads. And so we have to have a serious conversation in this entire region about what that's going to mean, because it's going to have to mean compromises.
Get Matt to jump in here. I mean, Jana makes a point that maybe our expectations are unrealistic. Maybe the dream of that 905 of days gone by, that idea of suburban big houses and sprawling lots, is over.
It's going to be over at least within a certain limit within the region. I mean, you already put up the map showing the green space. We're going to fill it in. And I mean, Red, you've been talking about like the process issues and the OMB and stuff. But you've got to zone the density somewhere. I mean, maybe the process can be improved, but I mean, the population's growing naturally because, you know, children are being born and families are moving in from other parts of Canada. The federal government and the provincial government are streaming in immigrants to the region. So I don't know who's approving it, but God help us if we didn't. I mean, where are we going to actually put these people? I mean, Brian, you've said a greater Montreal area is moving into the GTA in the next 15 to 20 years. We got to put them somewhere. And if either we're going to build 10 more Caledons every 10 years, or we're going to build up and out. And you know, it's funny when you're driving around, as I do. I mean, I live in the suburbs, so you drive. All the houses that are being built are detached four bedrooms on the big pie shaped or square shaped lot. So I don't know if we've realized this yet, but you know, when I look at this, and I say this to my wife when we're heading up to that cottage, and we're not seeing the cranes, but we're seeing the bulldozers, and we're seeing the giant piles of dirt, and we're seeing new subdivisions going in, and literally hundreds of kilometers of sewer pipes and hydro wires and all the things you need to sustain a community. I'm like, every one of these people is going to be driving down the highway every day trying to get into the city. We haven't realized this yet. We just haven't noticed.
Other cities have done this. You know, it's not a secret. You take a look at LA. LA used to be the most congested city in North America, and it's not now. And it's spent something like $40 billion on transit and has an LRT, not a subway, but an LRT to Long Beach, to Orange County, to Santa Monica, to Glendale. You think about Paris. Paris is spending something like $20 billion taking their transit out to the suburbs on the other side of the ring road that goes around Paris. London has got, you know, unbelievable transit that goes fast train from Heathrow to the city of London. Other places have done it. Now, how have they done it? They've done it with mayors that have had a vision for what can be in the city. They've had whole areas that have come together. Denver is a fascinating example. Denver actually had a proposal for a 1% sales tax that was voted down, and it ended up being suburbs versus the city. 10 years later, they did it all, and nothing got built. Surprise, surprise. 10 years later, they had the same referendum. It got voted in. It was then a metro council that supported it. And Denver is now building an incredible transit plan. Our transit system is our bloodstream. It's our arteries. And we're clogging them up. And what's going to happen is we're going to end up losing parts of our body.
One of the problems with the culture in the political chattering class within Toronto over the last couple of years has been that, you know, sewer pipes and roads and bridges were not as politically sexy as daycare centers, theaters, I mean, all of the, you know, gay pride, all those wonderful projects that are important to Toronto, you know, add to the quality of life, but people forgot the infrastructure. And one of the reasons that right now everybody, of course, is complaining about construction. Everywhere you go is construction within Toronto. Well, the good news about that is that finally, whether it's the mayor or the current council, whoever you want to give the credit to, is trying to catch up on the infrastructure, on paving roads. I mean, there were some roads that you could come down there, and quite literally, you were lucky if you were doing the speed limit to keep the undercarriage of your car there when you were hitting the old corduroy roads of pioneer days. They're at least starting to fix that. But you look at the sewer and water pipes in this town. I mean, if you actually looked at some of the old ones, and on some of those construction sites, you know, when they're doing things and they pull up those old pipes that are still carrying water, you kind of get, ooh, that doesn't look very nice.
So. Rusty.
All right. Rest tubes. So we just got a couple minutes left.
And I just quick go around the table. Brad, I'm going to start with you. Yeah. Bring it back full circle. Is it healthy to have this division between the 905 and 416? Any good in it?
Yes. I think it's better for all of us because everyone's growing. And we're all citizens here. We all are people who have families and lives. I want to have a better life. We need to have this divide. I think at the same time, Toronto needs to understand that it's a growing. We're not growing, we are here now at the table. And within the 905, we need to have a more mature discussion about how we stop thinking about 1987, we are the 905, and feel like the outcast, and start acting like we're the major player at the table.
Okay, Brian, healthy divide?
I think the healthy is unhealthy, but sometimes it takes an unhealthy something rather to get something new that's better. I think that we are broken. We are not operating like a Greater Toronto Region, and it's because we are the 416 versus the 905. And I think the only solution is some sort of institutional structure. It doesn't have to be formal. It could be an informal structure. There used to be a council of mayors chaired by both the mayor of Toronto and the mayor of Mississauga, but got all the people together to talk about what's the solution for the Greater Toronto area. That's what we need.
All right, Janet, you got 30 seconds.
Well, we don't have a choice. There are divides and tensions, and the only way out of it is a collaborative exercise on behalf of our political class to try and work together to solve some of the issues.
Matt, last word.
I think it's unhealthy, but I don't think it's going to go anywhere. I mean, we divided the city into area codes for a reason. We were running out of room. So the area codes, quite frankly, are a symptom of the problem. We're growing faster than we know how to deal with.
Exactly. We could use the wine. Maybe that would help us calm down.
We're getting new area codes. We'll all have to learn new digits.
It'll be the fifth and sixth of the area,
All right. Yeah. Everyone, 905ers, thank you very much. Thanks for coming in today. Enjoy the commute home.
Support Ontario's public television. Donate at tvo.org.